Good evening. Appreciate your coming out this evening. Very excited to have with us Dr. Edwin Nichols here this evening. Dr. Nichols is a clinical industrial psychologist who specializes in organizational development. And his work is international. He's worked with Fortune 500 companies, he's worked with embassies, governments around the world. And he's here tonight to talk to us about the philosophical aspects of cultural difference. And for some of us who have been working with Dr. Nichols, I've had that pleasure for about 3 years, thanks to some work in the Habitat and AmeriCorps program, we were able to hook up first and do some cultural diversity training with some of our AmeriCorps members. And he's been very gracious to be involved here at Allstate, entering a partnership, creating a tape series, which we hope have edited available within the month. Some of you were here this summer or were able to be part of the workshop. I'm looking forward to another workshop tomorrow with the faculty. So please welcome Dr. Nichols, who is here this evening. And Dr. Nichols, thank you very much for taking the time to be with us.
Alright? So if the two isms give privilege, then let's see what, how it works. If we are a sexist society, who is good? Then, hold a minute, sir. This is one level of privilege. Okay? So you see that you, the people sitting next to you are what? Women. And therefore, they don't have as much what as you. Privilege. Privilege. Okay? Well, that's called privilege. All right. Now, what is the other reason that we have in our society? If you're not white, sit down. If you're not white, sit down. Now, you see, those of you that are standing have how many privileges?
Two.
Two levels of privilege. I thank you. Now, those in the room that are in a sexist society and are not male, which means they have less privilege, stand. Ago, for the first time in some 40 years, the House of Representatives changed from domination by the two race to the political analysts and said, why? What happened? What happened? The political analysts told us it was because of the vote of angry white males. Who are they and why they were angry? Well, we have phenomena going on in our country that we have to understand, and I'll give you an explanation of that. But what I want you to understand is that that group of men are angry, but their anger sometimes is systematic. We'll have to analyze that. Because some of you represent, in the future, postgraduates, or in some of the same group. And if you don't keep your what up current, then you will be behind. You will have a job. Why do you feel so central to be worried about skills today? What's happening? Why do those high school graduates not have a job? Why is this the problem? All right, the 30th of June this year, major global events in the U.S. What is it? The 1st of July, which will take place this year, 1997. There, see it? Yes, Hong Kong. Not Hong Kong, the piece of land going back to the piece of land. It's the Bank of Hong Kong becomes the Bank of China. That's really important stocks. What city has more billionaires than any other city in the world? Hong Kong, they're what? Chinese. Okay. Not billionaires, but people say. Billionaires, and they're Chinese. You have hundreds of millions of Chinese who are skilled workers and hundreds of thousands of Chinese who are professionals. But in our racism, we always have two number schools with you. That was the error that we made with the Japanese. We made them say that one time the Japanese can only copy. Well, they always copy what's out of existence. Okay? Now, for the first time, they'll have enough what? And they will buy the newest capital index capital goods is to make products. The tool and that, the newest machinery. Not obsolete machinery from the former Union of Soviet Socialist Republics. The newest technological advanced computerized equipment to make billions of whatever they want to make. Now, how many of you work for $100 a month, $8 a day, $15 a day, and really work excellent salary? No? Well, the Chinese work at that somewhere in the year, that's somewhere about $200 a month. Is that interesting? So they will work at these machines, hundreds of millions of them, producing what we used to produce here as industrial manufacturing. So the jobs that people previously found in this country that were basically those of industrial manufacturing will become where? China and the Pacific Rim. Where? How close are we to that reality? Think of the last three purchases that you made. Turn them to the reverse side. You see a little rose with their notes written inside. Made in China. Yes. Are they crappy? No. They're good quality. And they're making food because they'll have more money. So the people in this country, in all these little towns in Indiana, they used to have jobs as high school graduates, earning middle class income as an industrial manufacturing company, will not have A1. Yes. Because they don't have the necessary one for today's workforce. Yes. Now let's look to see why the political analysts said angry white men. Who were they and why they were angry? What we have to do now is we have to look at the development organization structure in this country. Businesses have a structure, and it was developed over time. And as you look at it in a reflective way, and you'll be able to anticipate some sense of issues and problems. Okay? How many of you of European descent have relatives that came to this country after the Civil War? Raise your hands. After the Civil War. Alright? Coming after the Civil War, Europe did not have universal primary education, which means that everyone could go to what? Only very special people. If you were Dutch, you wouldn't have gotten. gotten what is called habeas, which is quod curia. That's an affluent citizen. Alright? But that's not for everyone, is it? So how much education do you think those individuals that came to this country have? No public education, how much do they have? None. Alright? Let's take a look here. This is a group of people who had limited education. They came to this country, they entered into the factories, and they worked with their hands. How many of you, of your Indian relatives, that were in this country before the Civil War? You're very fortunate because so were they. They had the advantage, even in the most rural environment, of an eighth grade education through the one room what? Schoolhouse. That's a unique thing for the United States. They entered into the factories and worked with their heads. They worked as clerks, payroll clerks, any work, stock work, timekeeper. All of the things that require that you read and write and do arithmetic in what language? Yes, and they did it exceptionally well. We need to go back and look at the penmanship for that time. The fact that they didn't misspell words. So when you turn in papers at this college, people ask spelling questions. In fact, people like to spell and count. Do you think it counts? Of course it counts. Yes, it counts. All right. Now, eighth grade education. How do they get paid as people in these organizations? They got an annual one. Yes, if you have an annual salary, you can go to the bank and get a loan and buy a, yes, a house, but a house, cars are still available at that time. A house, which makes you middle class. So we begin to develop our middle class now. It's beginning there. Before we were all an agrarian society, it was contingent on how many acres you could plant. Do you think that any man could take one standard deviation more acres than another would be able to plant? The answer is one. No, it's one of the nonsense. It's other than pretty much the same. But for the most part, it's been a lot of sun. Alright, now let's look to see how the workers that worked with their hands were paid. How many were paid? By the what? Hour and piece work. So they couldn't get a loan. They couldn't get a loan. What was the first building they built in their communities when they first came to this country? The people who worked with their hands. What's the first building they built in their community? A church. Now they realize education is important. What is the second building they build? And to what level? Eighth grade. Now I'm going to teach you a secret. If you want to maintain power and control, you change the rules. So now it's time to do what? What time is it now? Change the rules. That's very nice that you're going to make for education, but if you want to come into our class as a supervisor, you need a high school diploma. Now, once you have that, you can be a supervisor. What is the function of a supervisor? Well, we specialize in the supervision of supervisors, who supervises the workers. And of course, supervisors at level 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 got more luck. Because they have more luck. Yes, and entitled. World War II is over, it's apparent that the United States is to maintain a competitive edge in the world market. We must have a workforce that is better educated. So, we sent all those individuals to college on the GI Bill. And we had to develop a new category of people. And these were called managers. And what was their function? They specialized in the management of managers who would be managed, other managers who managed, managed, and the workers. Now, during this time, I want to hear, the workers felt they deserved more what? Yes. They said, but you don't have enough what? Yes. They said, but we do all what? Someone had to come and save the workers. Who came to save the workers? Yes, the union. So we have here for the workers the union as the savior. Now, for this group of people, human is the scourge of Western civilization. Okay. Now, we have this many managers responsibility to supervise. So now we have a group of vice presidents, and we need an MBA for them. Now who are they? Well, the junior vice president reports to a vice president who reports to a senior vice president who reports to an executive vice president who reports to a senior executive vice president. Now it's time to do what the deal is. This, of course, we have a small group here. These are called administrative executives. Nothing is written out here because they deserve to be here. These are the at where one time, God's dream is the CEO. Now, that's a quick shorthand of organizational development structure in the United States. So we develop a what kind of structure? Vertical structure and organizational structure. It's hierarchical, and it's hierarchical contingent upon who has the most money and power, except when we do what we will. Yes. Alright. Now, everyone knew if you got more money, you would earn more money and prestige. Now, how to move in this system? Well, you have to prove that you love us. Now, how are we going to prove to you that you love us? We must be loyal. So each time you go up for a promotion every 3 years, you have to relocate your family. We ask you to move. Now, of course, there are times when the wife says to the husband, as it was at that time, the children and I are staying here, even more if you want to, but we're not moving. And that was simply because the daughter would be one in high school at that time. If she didn't go to her what, the world would come too late. Yes, you know the answer, of course, exactly. So he would report this back to his boss, and his boss would say, well, yes, I understand this, but he must understand that her promotion will be held in abeyance to the lateral until such time as you relocate. Which says you've got a year to get your act together. Now, if the next year, the next 2 years, you don't elect to relocate, then they will demote you one level and give you 6 months to get out of the corporation without a negative level of reference. Everyone understood? Everyone played the game? They were followers. Oh, now we have women here. Women and minorities would have been subjected to the last one. Yes, so the line is about a whole tomorrow over here. It's last year. Okay? So we're talking primarily about white males, about 40 years of age and up. Okay? Now let's see what happens. How many people took physics? Aha. Very good. Then, if you take this superstructure, and you superimpose it on this base, what's likely to occur? The whole thing will work. Engineering, marketing, for students. The collapse will. I would hope so. That is training in marketing to recognize the collapse in the company. That is hope. Okay. All right. Now, they collapsed. Major firms, including the Atlantic Seaboard, and through Pennsylvania, Ohio, Indiana, and into Illinois. So companies just simply won. But now, if you went to the country club and one of your country club members was no longer there because his company had won, it would terrorize you. Because that could happen to you, or your stock is in your company, it would collapse. You'd be wrong. Well, this group makes the decision that they get out. Now, the only way to get out is you have to sell your life. If you go to Wall Street and you say, I want to sell all my stock this morning at 9 o'clock, at 9:01 the stock is totally gone. You're the business, of course. So you can't do that. Now, it's impossible to sell it when you're not trading quarterly life. Yes, you have a dilemma. How can we turn profit when we're not producing enough to turn profit? Well, it's quite simple. We have a small problem. We've been working with this unit for a long time. This first question is, what's it? If those human beings were just one, their child and produce products, but they need one, cheapest lazy and other things, we would be all right. But they've not been, and they need to be punished. Well, we will fire 1,000. If you fire 1,000 workers times 3 months' salary, you could have a wife. Can't do it. It's a great problem. Now, psychologically, which one though? I know that if I one, two, three workers, I fire a week, two of who work 1.5 times as hard. So I'm getting the production company for the salary company. Yes. I also know that they'll work 2 quarters, 6 months before we run out. Now, if I'm getting 2 quarters, I have how many more to go? More to go. Do I burn out? Are they any available to me? And I need how many more quarters? What's the necessary thing to do with it? I'll simply buy. Yes, I'll fire another 1,000, it's nothing personal. Yes, what kind? Yes, of course. Now we have a slight problem. We have this group of men who are about the last year, had many years of experience, very good one, learning a lot of one, and prestige. But this morning they don't have a what? A job. How do you think of you? Yes. Anger turned upon the self is depression. Significant numbers of white males in the state of Massachusetts area ended up doing what? Committing suicide, yes. What do you think happened to spousal relationships in these situations? Yes. One to need just a little something to help them through the day, so what picked up? Yes, because they can no longer afford what? Successful. She has hustled and she has gotten contract A, contract B, C, and contract D. At this very moment, she is out trying her best to compete for contract what? Yes. Question. Is there anything to assure you that she will get that contract? What's the answer? What's the answer? No. 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 Now, if you are working on project A, and you are an excellent worker, exceptional, when project A is over, is there anything to assure you that you will work on project E? What's the answer? No. Now, for your parents who grew up in a situation where they were in the old model that I just had up here, they demanded loyalty. So as long as you were loyal, all you had to do to make sure that you stayed in the system was what? Okay? Well, for your group, there's nothing to demand what of you? Loyalty. Competence, efficiency, proficient, all these things are required of you. But no one can really require loyalty because no one can assure you that you will have another one. Yes. And for people sitting in the back, who are my age or younger, they are very distressed by that. But then your reality is that you won't be worried about loyalty. You'll be worried about can you produce what is necessary for a new job. So if you have only one area of specialty, how likely are you that you will stay employed? What's the answer? So you must have a greater width of competencies. I want to see what happens in terms of supervision. We have a situation here in which we have oversight. It works like this. That door opens, and everything that's necessary to work on project A is brought into this room this morning. You come in at 8 o'clock, you work on the projects. When the projects are completed, that door opens at 5 o'clock, and everything goes out. Now, if something happened in this room, and the machines broke out or something, someone has to monitor to make sure that everything is in there the next morning and working, and everything goes out on time. Can one person monitor 5 projects to keep everything in their head? What's the answer?
No.
So they're going to have to rely on what to do the monitoring. A what? A computer. Can you walk to a package, to a software package, to get one package that will take care of all the accidentals here? What's the answer? One package? No. So you will have to be able to do what for a package? Go in and what? Every one. Reprogram it to do the specific things that you have. How many of you can reprogram a package? Raise your hands. You won't have a job. How does it be unemployed? Because you won't have the necessary one. Yes. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? We really need only one skill. What's the answer? No, we need a myriad of skills. Now, how many of you can talk to us in the past? That you have the necessary math base to do what is necessary. So, if you have the math base necessary, you need to get what value of your food. Skills, then you'll be competent and efficient. Now let's look at something else, because there'll be some people that say, well, my goodness, Dr. Nichols, I'm looking for resources. Well, in this structure, you could have worked in human resources because there would have been a vice president for what? Human resources. Somewhere in the structure, you would have been housed. But in this structure, can this woman afford a full-time person for human resources? What's the answer? No, of course not. But she still needs those functions done. So you can be home pregnant for the fourth child, and if you can do computers, you can log in and do all the work that she needs done for what? Human resources. If you have the necessary what? Yes. Questions? Historically, we have gone from to yes, we are in transition period. We're not there yet. We're close, but we're not there. Can we expect it to work years in the same job? That's the answer. No. You will probably have two or three job changes even in a while. In 1 year when you first started your life. 2 years. Okay? So where we used to look and estimate how efficient you were working by how many job changes you had in a 5 year period of time, that's obsolete now. It would be what did you do and how many skills did you acquire that you could now apply in the same. You see what I'm saying? Is that helpful for you as young people at the university? Going into the 21st century? Can't hear you.
Yes.
All right, thank you. Yes?
Thank you.
well, there's some problems that come out of working at home. You're going back to what we used to do with the piece of work at home. You can live in a bad situation where people are not getting any benefits at all working at home. The way you cover yourself, okay, you are at home working as a human resource person. You build into your contract what? Retirement and health care. You bid on that. Then you're covered. Otherwise, without it, you won't have it. So, those are some real things you have to worry about. Like if you would be peaceful at home, what would you get? Oh, that's another part of it. Well, you see what will also happen is you'll have to interact with those that are immediately there. You can't always do that kind of work with children there. You can teach nursery schools and things like that, so you have some peace of mind. It doesn't always work that way. But the social interaction you will miss. But through email and things like that, there will be some social interaction. You'll become a more literate society. Yes?
Women in this room going to park about to get your car
and you see a black male crossing also, how do you respond? You see? And that's the same for black women and black men, because all of us share the same body, socialization. Now, what's the effect on a young black male stopped by the campus police? He says, I go to school with you. Give me your ID. Now, if he becomes indignant, how do police respond to acts of indignation? Is that interesting? You see what I'm saying? Are all socializations negative? The answer is no. What is a positive socialization? You're driving down the highway with your children in the car, you're going to pitch something out the window over the hallway. What do they demand before you start the motor? Yes, that's what I'm saying. Now, those are positive socializations. All socializations are not negative. Now, historically, this would have been considered a training room. And 4 or 5 years ago, people would have had glass discs at every other place, and by this point, the day, it would be voting one. Can't hear you. See, so far removed from the room by doing glass. Now, if we can stop people from smoking in public places in 3 years, through the medium of television, then can you see how powerful it is a tool? Then we can get rid of what? Racism, sexism, anti-Semitism, homophobia. All these things continually divide us so we're not a united front in our populace. You see what I'm saying? Alright. Now, there's something that gets in the way from time to time. They're called cultural biases. Cultural bias is the formation of ideas that are printed and shaped for the self. When we are first born, your family takes specific ideas, they imprint them into you, and make you who you are. Now, in essence, we are all born without biases. By the time we are 3.5 years of age, our families have permanently fitted us with sets of lenses through which we see the world for the rest of our lives. So that no matter where we look, when we look, how we look, we're always looking through the lenses of your cultural bias. These lenses have been thickened by the socialization of the society. Thick lenses connote impaired vision. My vision is impaired. I wear trifocals. Who among you wears trifocals? Raise your hand. Yes, sir. What is your name? David. David, do you see Edwin? Yes. Edwin, do you see David? Yes. You see each other clearly, of course you do. Now, there are those of you there who are not glasses, who are not glasses, who are not glasses. Is it possible for David or Edwin or trifolds to see anything clearly? David, how do we accomplish this feat? So you're clear. It's not sexual psychology. We are viewing the world with greatest layers of distortion, yet we claim clarity. I see it clearly. So what happens is when we're interacting with other people in the workforce, we assume we know something about them, and we go around all day long saying, yes, I understand this. But in fact, it's the greatest motion of this each other. What are some examples of cultural bias? Well, let's take a look at one. How many of you have been raised Lutheran or Episcopalian? All Lutherans and Episcopalians. So we've been talking about Catholics. How many of you are Catholic? You know about the Protestants, don't you? How many of you are Jewish? Beware of the Goyim. They'll get you. Now, are there any Baptists in this whole place? Any Baptists at all? Yours is true salvation. Others will be on a long line way to moving inside rejoicing. I see cultural biases always have for the individual a measure of truth from their thought process. Why is it that the Baptist will tell you that they'll be inside rejoicing and everyone else will be on a long line waiting? Because only the Baptist is improperly what? Baptized, yes. The others are just sprinkled, not what? Immersed, that's it. Yes. The Baptist and a few words, that's it. The rest of you have to wait. That's it. Go on by. Now, from the perspective of the Baptist or the Mormons, that's the proper way to what? Baptize. So as far as they're concerned, the rest will have to do. Alright. Now, what I'm sharing with you is all of us have many cultural biases. And there's nothing wrong with the cultural bias as long as it is not an impediment in the workplace. If people say, I'm only going to promote Protestants in Northern Ireland, we have some serious problems. So, you see what I'm saying? So as long as your cultural bias is not about an impediment where, it's a nice about home in your private life, a nice to work, then you need to transcend. Right? Now, what is required of you as young people for the 21st century? You must be culturally competent. And there's a difference between culturally aware and culturally competent. Now, that's an excellent definition. It's been stored in many sources, and I've added to it, and this is added to it. You can't even decide to come up with that definition. It's on the paper. But here's another way of thinking about it. Let's have you come on. Dr. Woollen is here. Yes. And let's have you face each other.
They share a common worldview.
Those who share a common worldview, historically, things changed for them forever. They were forced to speak another language totally, exclusively, and forced to convert to a religion. So in our country, people really classify as Hispanics and share a common worldview. They were subjected to colonial Spain, forced to speak Spanish, and forced to convert to Catholicism. To be Hispanic is not race contingent. You can be white Hispanic, black Hispanic, or white American Hispanic. You can be Jose Wong and still be white Hispanic. It's also not contingent on nationality. You can be from Argentina, Peru, Colombia, Miami, Harlem. But if you were subjected to colonial Spain historically, forced to speak Spanish, forced to convert to Catholicism, then you in this country, by definition, share a common worldview and you are Hispanic. What Asian country, had it not been for the Spanish-American War, would also be classified as Hispanic today? Do you have any idea at all for young for that? Yes, the Philippines. The Philippines would be the exact answer. Okay. Now, philosophy is the mother science. It's the most important of the sciences. Others are lesser sciences. This is another science. I'm a psychologist. This is a lesser science. I'm a clinical psychologist. I am a psychoanalyst with advanced training at Zurich. My vision of the world is extremely narrowly one. Focus, discipline. Now, because I'm the analyst with advanced training at Zurich, I'm the good, and what do all we need? Yes, Alan. You're sick, you're advanced. Yes, yes, that's it. I'm going to go through the operation problem. See how that works? That's how we get stereotyped. Now let me show you another stereotype. Accountant, auditor, tax auditor for the IRS. What does that mean? All of the guilty eye. Yes. Because he's the good, then you're the operation prime. You see how stereotyping is done? All right. Now, we have to go beyond that to the mother science. And the mother science forces us to see essences that transcend time. Okay, so again, we don't have enough time for that, so trust me. There are three disciplines that I would use among the many disciplines in classical philosophy. I'm going to use the discipline of axiology, epistemology, and logic. Axiology is the study of values. Epistemology asks, how do you know knowledge? And logic asks, how to reason to an answer? Okay, so those are the three things that we're going to know. I know that much about you. I can pretty much understand who you are and how best to work with you effectively and efficiently. All right. Axiologies don't develop in 100 years or 1,000 years. So we have to go back to North Central Europe 12,000 years ago. If the time capsule opened and you're placed in North Central Europe 12,000 years ago, resources are very wanting in North Central Europe 12,000 years ago. Very much. Very scarce. Right? All right. I have the resources. The winter is coming. If you need this resource to survive the winter and you're not physically taken away from me, then how must you act toward me in order to have access to the resource? So what we're developing is in Europe a hierarchy that is based upon the top of the hierarchy having the what? The resources. All right? Now take that construct, put it into philosophy, and then look for epidemiographic data to corroborate it. This philosophically becomes the object. So there's subject and what? Object. And the values here, because this is the what? Survival. Okay? All right? In 1929, there was a crash. Many people lost everything. It's significant. Numbers of white males did what? Yes. So I told you also what happened after this downsizing situation. Significant numbers of white males did what? Because they lost that which within was the object of what? Highest value. Now, does object mean materialism? No. Object can be power, control, and authority, and those are not what? Materialistic. So don't think materialism, that's fallacious. All right. So we have one group who has the highest value line in the object or its acquisition. And these are people that come from the linear to object. All right, now let's see what happens if we go to Equatorial Africa 12,000 years ago. What about resources there? Resources will be mine. If you're hungry, you just want to go in, that's it. So they're bombing. So you don't have to spend many months preparing to store food. It's omnipresent. So if everything that you need is omnipresent, then where do people spend their time? They spend their time in developing what between themselves. Yes. Now, with the highest valorizing of the relationship, people see themselves to be watched to each other. Equal. If you do something that treats me as less than equal, you're treating me with what? Disrespect and a destroyed relationship. It's a very important concept. Even though you outrank me, I still expect you to treat me with what? Yes, because I expect you to treat me as a what? But you see, in the hierarchical system, you can't do this, there's no problem here, is it? It's the difference between two systems. Now, suppose you can come here up where in police studies, law enforcement. Any of you here? Okay, well, let's look at this anyway. If you were going to a prison and you asked the young black male, why did you kill your husband or your best friend? He says, man, he won. Yes, he this, he has black English. He got this. He this, which means he treated him with what? Which destroys the relation, because that's the highest value. Life is secondary or tertiary. That's very quickly going to see what happens to the Asian construct. The Asian construct says the highest value lies in the what? Yes, period. In the cohesiveness of the what? Alright. Remember I told you about the other side of the dollar bill? I don't know how Asians perceive the concept of rudeness. Because if I look at my dictionary, whose name is on top of my dictionary? Webster. I'm interested in Webster, made to Japan. Then they can even get across the Mississippi. Okay. Now, if I'm going to write something about them, I have to see it from their perspective. A secret that I've learned is if you write the word in their language, then it will help you. Now, it's dyslexic because I'm dyslexic in English, so you're dyslexic in Chinese, okay? Don't worry about it. All right, this is the word for group, and this one is king, and this one is she. So in order to be a group, you have a leader and what? Followers. Leader and what?
Followers.
But the language is much more sophisticated than that. In modern years hierarchy, we see sheep as stupid dumb animals, they see sheep as conformist animal. So the essence of groupness is to be a conformist within the hierarchy. That's what Diddy demanded in his protocol of marriage to kind of conformist teams. That in order to keep the group cohesive in the workplace, you have to be a conformist within the hierarchy. It wasn't that they were so smart and they were so dumb. It was that it was already built into their axiology. Now, how to make a decision in this organization that keeps a group cohesive? How tall are you, sir? Yes. Pardon? 6'3". You are taller than 6'3". Yes, how tall are you? 6'5". 6'7". Since we are going north for water, who am I going to talk to? He has made a unilateral decision. Unilateral decisions, however, do not keep a group cohesive, because if we get north and there's no water, how long would you be in charge? Not very well. Right. Thank you very much. Let's see what we learned from the Greeks. Majority rule. All those in favor of going north for water, please raise your hands. He's going to go north, he's going to go south. All right. You break the tie, north or south? North, yeah, maybe. Okay. You see what happens? We keep splitting, because the majority rule does not keep it group one. Cohesive. Nor does the unilateral decision. So then we must understand how to keep the group cohesive in their culture. You come to a right to the decision making process. Consensus, yes. And how do I get consensus? And what is the etymology of the word? All right. Now, this word as a single Chinese word. It's a Chinese word for heart. And the word about it, if it's written as a single word, is the Chinese word for voice. So in order to come to consensus, your heart and your voice have to say the what? How many times have you said something with your voice and you mean with your heart? Yes, that's called passive-aggressive behavior. This is the diagnostic statistical manual used by psychiatrists to classify mental illness. Now, if I know how you think and feel, either your affect or intellect, then, and I write the word just as a single Chinese word, and the new word is intent. So if I know how you think and feel, I know your what? I know your intent. Now, if we all have the same intent to work 7 days a week, 12 hours a day, to produce 1,500 widgets, does anyone have to be awakened to do it on time? What's the answer? No, because I told you with my what? My heart and my voice, and the two of them tell me my what? Intent, and we all have the same intent. Now we use the second word, and this is the second word. We can now all come together and speak with one mouth, and that's a consensus. Who writes Chinese? Come on, someone writes Chinese. Who writes Chinese? Who's Japanese? Anyone writing Japanese? Japanese? Who writes these characters? We don't know these characters, okay. I want someone who was educated either in Japan or China to write them, because when I talk about epistemology, you can see something else I want to show you. That's okay. All right. Now, this says that if we understand the values of the individuals, we will know something about their what? Behavior. So let's look at some of these real quickly. If the highest value lies in the object, the person is preoccupied with the task. So when I walk into an office, I'm preoccupied with the task, I may forget to do what? Reach. And walk right by. How does it feel if the highest value of his culture is a relationship? Have I got anything to establish a relationship? What's the answer? Am I racist, bigot? No. I just been preoccupied with my own axiology, which is the what? The task. Okay? Now, he comes in and says, when I'm focused on the what? He says, good morning, hey man, how are you doing? He's interrupting me from completing my what? Yes. He's over there, some noise, right? He's such a noise. He says, damn, I walked in there, I said, good morning, I don't want to say anything, they're all racist. You see how we get a misperception? That it's just simply that we have two axiologies operative here. Now, suppose you've just come from Japan, where the group is the most important thing. And you walk into a classroom where everyone's competing for a what? A grade on a very low kind of basis. Individualistic basis. Do you share your notes? No, you better get your own. I ain't sharing what matters to you. Because I want the what? I want the A. If I know something you don't know, I mean, what? You have the A. Well, that's not the way other cultures work. At the university level, they will be very competitive on the exam, but not competition among what? Themselves, because they think they have to keep the group apart. What is it? You see? If you're the one that stands and says, I'm the smartest one in class, well, in Japanese culture, they say, the nail that sticks up is the one that is what? Pounded it down. Okay? See, the individualism that we have in our country is not considered to be normal in other societies. Can you see now the conflict that comes when students come from overseas and try to enter, or Japanese Americans from someplace else, or Black Americans from someplace else, or European Americans? We're all in the same classroom, but we have a different value system that superimposes itself in our interpersonal relationships, which would prevent and preclude us from doing our project effectively because we don't understand something about the person. And very quickly, I'll give you one of the set, which is epistemology. This is very important for you. All right. The epistemology asks, how do you know something? In Western culture, we go through counting and measuring. Now, that is the epistemology. Pedagogically, how do you teach it to a student? You give them a card, and the cards become the what? The whole. What is your methodology? Linear and sequential. A follows B follows C follows D follows E follows F. Put parts to the whole, counting and measure, linear and sequential, into a fact. Tell me what it is. Assembly line. Henry Ford made us a billion-dollar nation because he applied Western epistemology to the a production on the leaders. And we got to be a new denomination, first time. Okay? Now, let's see how that works in terms of your assignments. We assign you a what? And we give you exercises in that part that you have to what? And on Monday. Tuesday, we give you another what? With exercises you must what? Wednesday. Thursday. Friday, we give you a test on what? And some people don't do too well. Because all those parts didn't make a what for them. Yes, they have not understood the whole. Now let's go to another epistemological model and see what happens there. With blacks and Hispanics, we have what is called symbolic imagery and rhythm, which means function. I don't talk about clapping your hands, why can't I function? If your heart is out of rhythm, it is not blocked properly. Yes. In this group, people want to be able to see the whole. What are you talking about? And the way problems are solved is to cut to the what? Yes, which is critical path. That's the methodology to solving problems. To use a critical path, the shortest distance to get there. All right, now let's look at some of these things. If you are always asking what is the what, and your teacher only gives you a what, then you may not be able to put all those parts into a what. Is it because you're dumb? It's because you need a different physiological model for instruction. Now, suppose you have a black teacher who starts off talking about the what. And then, 3 weeks into the course, he's still talking about the what. He said, oh Lord, would you please give me my what so I can go do my work? Isn't that interesting? That's how it works with the job sometimes. All right, now, here's the function of epistemologists. This is a real dilemma. There's a whole group of people in the world that use this way of reading and writing. Now, based on what you know so far, we have talked about a pedagogy. This is a transcendental epistemology. These are people who have high starting points in this is a group. This is the transcendental epistemology. If you understand this, you can connect it to its universal truth. Then, using these two words, tell me what is necessary to understand that. How would you teach children to read that? What do you have to do in order to read that? You have to be able to see the what first. The what? The whole character. So we say whole. Then you have to be able to see all the what. How? Simultaneously. Because you can't read Chinese linear and sequential. You cannot say, now that's an interesting line, but what is yours? Well, there are two of those. Are they cute? And that, it just kind of goes there by itself. Well, the man who printed this thing out being Chinese, and he missed this flow. So when I have Chinese in the audience, you see them do this. Because it's not there. They keep saying, it's not a word unless all the what are there. All the parts are there. And you must be able to see the whole of the parts how? Simultaneously. So now if you've got a team where someone can see the what, and the person that can see the whole of the parts what, says, this is the order we should get the what in order to make what? And we're going to do it in a what fashion? Linear and sequential. Whose office is going to be? You'll win because you have all these possibilities on your team. But if you only have one possibility, what's going to happen? You'll solve problems immediately because you're all thinking the same way. But when you get to serious problems, you won't be able to solve them as rapidly as a team that is what? Multi-ethnic and holistic. There's research work at the University of Michigan to corroborate that. Okay? Now, that's the work environment you're working with. You don't understand it. Be serious. Let me show you what are some of the problems. How many of you heard of O.J. Simpson? You heard of O.J. Simpson? All right. Let's take the first trial and see what happens in the O.J. Simpson trial using this paragraph. Marsha Clark addressed the jurors as though they were a collective what? Object. She presented material to them as a series of what? That she could what? The evidence, blood drops, all kinds of things, okay? And she gave it to them in a linear and sequential what? Way. Johnny Cochran, if you look at his eyes, He is trying to establish with the jury a what? Yes, because he addresses each person on the jury directly in their what? Eyes. Okay? Now he's going to have to present symbolic images to them. Well, an example of symbolic imagery is keep your eye on the prize. And this is a like an image of the difference. Keep your eye on the prize means with all the dogs and segregation and all the things that happen in the South, it's a rights movement. This is only temporary. Keep your eye there on the prize. Don't be swallowed up by all these little details. Keep your eye there on the prize. All right? Do you see how his speech was? Okay. Did he get rid of it? Yes, he did. Did he teach you the rhythm process? Yes. He says, if it doesn't fit, you must. Let's say that three times in a row. Let's do it three times in a row. Let's say kind of bigger. I know it would be difficult for you to say it, but let's try it. If it doesn't fit, let's go. Symbolic imagery and what? Rhythm. And you talked about the what? The whole, the big picture. Alright? Now, he had to defend some argument that had come up from the other side, and this is how he did it, by going to the critical path, which is the evidence relevant beyond the shadow of doubt? Well, Dr. Lee was his best person. Dr. Lee has spent many years reading what? Being able to see the what? The whole amount of parts what? So Dr. Lee looked at the bloody footprints and he could see another set of one in there. Footprints. Because he could see all the little what? And see the aberration and recognize it as another set of footprints. Dr. Lee asked a very interesting question. Dr. Lee said, this is a sock on which there are blood stains. The sock has external side A, external side D. Inside B and inside C. We found blood on side A, B, and C. My question is, how is that possible if the foot is in the sock at the time the blood splatters? It's interesting, isn't it? So what Johnny Cochran was doing was giving you enough data that says this is beyond the shadow of the doubt. Are there too many what? Too many things that you can begin to what? Doubt in the things. See? Now, when the jurors, when they have this doubt in their head and see the what? The hole. Are they in the box somewhere? They're right there listening to them. So they pretty much come to a what? Right in the box. Yeah, so they don't need 5 days to sit outside the way because they've come to the what? The conclusion because this is not a real what? A hole. What was his function? To put holes in what Dr. Park had given. And that's what he's done. Now we have Judge Ito. Judge Ito comes from what culture? Highest value line in the policeman's of the what? He works with these people every day, even his wife is a police officer. So he has to keep that with what? Cohesive. Now, there would be opposition from this side, opposition from this side, the opposite on both sides. He had to keep the group what? Then how can you make a decision that keeps the group cohesive? You come to a what? Consensus, and that's called sidebar. There were no side, there have not been sidebars in the whole history of jurisprudence in California that he had in his one case. But he was trying to get people to come to a what? The prosecution and the other side. He was trying to get the two sides to come to a consensus. Now, once they came to a consensus, then he could go back to being the what? The king, and they were the what? Conformists, or the sheep. You see what's going on? Now, what happened though is one man. This is regarding black, feels that Ito must treat this one equal, even though Ito outranks it. You understand that? Otherwise, Ito is treated with what? Yes. But Ito wants to maintain the cohesiveness of the one and keep his position in the hierarchy as the judge. Darwin was supposed to come to a one. In the sidebar, a what? Consensus, but he only spoke with his what? And not his what? Aha. Then when he went back, he started speaking with his mouth. And Judge Eagle could have lost what? Face. Fine. But this man says, I see myself as what? Even though they're on radio, and continues to talk. And Judge Eagle could have lost what on national television. So he says, I find it with contempt. And Darby then felt what on national television? He felt this. Yes. You see what happened? Now, why do you think the members of the black community feel that this last trial was payback? Because most of the issue is being resolved is how much what they can get from it. Yes, which is then the what? Yes. If we are to understand each other, we must know more about each other. If we don't understand anything about each other, then we don't make progress. Because this is Black History Month, I will close with a couple of things that should be of interest to you in terms of Black history. In Black history, there are many times that people have not been given credence as being people of color. So how many of you have studied English literature, English history? Alright. This is Charlotte Mecklenburg von Schlegels. She is the wife of King George III, grandmother of Queen Victoria. Now that's a portrait that you see very often, or one similar to it. But when she left Germany and was crowned, this is the portrait of her coronation, and this woman is one. Yes, she is. You see her hand on the crown and the scepter? There she is at coronation. Now the only explanation that I can give you is that if she went to England looking like this as a young black woman, see what happens if you stay in England too long. All right. Now, that's to help you understand that there is black mobility in Europe. Well, could it be real? Yes, of course. How real is it? Well, there were a lot of black people that were part of the nobility for Europe. Here's another very significant one. This is Wenzel Herzog von Sachsen. Herzog is a duke that becomes the crown prince from 1763 to 1768, and what bloodline runs in that German nobility? So these two bases, what are they? Lions, yes. Now someone will tell you they're those are little messenger boys. Would you put messenger boys in your family press? Would you defeat people on your family press? Of course not. How many of you might have German? I might have black blood if you're part of European nobility. Well, if your family crest looks like this and you're from Italy, or from France, or from Germany, well, you may be in trouble. Okay? Now, here's the other thing I want to share with you. Here is a family crest that we have here, European women. See the European women? And right here we have their side of the left side is the side of Filipino language. Because the left side is by as good as the right. Yes, in sexist things. Yes, sexist that is. Well, we see our horns here for Alpine or Viking lineage. That's these women. Now on this side, we have the family lineage, which is very close to the church, and we have the sword for fighting. The most important figure is always in the center at the top, and there he is. A brother with an afro and a jalapa. Does he have the authority to be there against the scepter? Is the power to stay there against the sword? Well, who is he? Himself, Freiherr, Reichherr, von Merdeburg, Phil Schaff, and Kennedy, 1666. So there you have the examples of blacks in African ability. Now, for those of you that are trying to figure out how they got there, how many of you know something about the Spanish Moors and their expulsion from Spain? Where did many of them go? They didn't go to Africa. Well, in 1516, the Habsburgs come to power, the Spanish Habsburgs, and they have a colony in what part of the northern part of Europe? What is their colony? What country? No, but that's later. But the earliest colony is where? A colony of Spain is the Netherlands. So many of these people went where? To Holland. What country in Europe has very high tolerance rates for intermarriage and all those kinds of things in Europe today? The Netherlands. Okay? Do you see how things link and connect? Now, here's the last thing I'm going to show you. This is Life magazine, July 5th, 1968. Is it down here? What is the special issue on the left? Up where? Aha, the presidency of the United States. Okay. This couple is pictured in there. The woman is what? Lithuanian, Russian, Norwegian. Now what is she? She's black. Yes. If your mother is black, what are you? Black. Aha. This is Eisenhower's mother, President Eisenhower. This is mother and his father at their wedding in Kansas. If your mother, father, if your mother's black, what are you? Or is it time to change the rules? Isn't that interesting? What I'm sharing with you is that if you know something about my side of the what? Of the dollar bill, then you will know more about what? Me. And we can have a better interaction and be culturally bound to each other. And as Americans, win the prize. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you.